It is that time of the week. It is the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, a weekly program where we spend some time to call out the establishment on their BS. And of course, I should start by saying that the following thoughts, views, and opinions are not necessarily those of 89.1 FM, WIDR Kalamazoo, or Western Michigan University, no matter how dope or on point they happen to be. So, we're going to lead in with the show. I wanted to talk about some local politics going on. Before we do, I usually like to start the program with a song or a jingle. So, I don't know if I'm necessarily even going to talk about this at great length on the program today, but I got off work and, tell me what, if you're out there, maybe you had a similar experience, but you put a little meme out there about, so it's a little joke about how, and I don't really want to get too much into this because I feel like not only have I talked about it to death, but so has just about everybody else. But, you know, the idea that the Russians hacked our election, quote unquote, so, it's basically like this funny little meme where it's like, oh, Vladimir Putin has revealed the Russian spies that influenced the election. And there's like a picture of Debbie Wasserman Schultz and Donna Brazile and Hillary Clinton. And, by the way, anybody, if you don't have anyone on your Facebook feed who, disagrees with your political views, you're doing it wrong. You're supposed to have people who disagree with you. That's healthy debate, you know, whatnot. So, you know, I had some people jump on this who were all, because I've been pretty vocal questioning the whole Russian narrative, questioning it, you know. And the first thing he said, it's like, oh, Andy's going on about how Russia had nothing to do with it again, blah, blah, blah. And it brought up a lot of points that I've been thinking about this whole thing, which what it really boils down to is this. And I had a dear friend who brought up an important point. It's like, why do we keep talking about this? We need to focus on the issues. And by all means, we do. But that's exactly why I keep talking about it, because the contents of what was inside those WikiLeaks, whether Russia had anything to do with it or not, are more important than this conversation about Russia. And furthermore, what I'm discussing now, this has nothing to do with whether Russia did it or not. I am just talking about what is actually happening. What is happening in the mainstream media is that this Russian narrative is being used to obscure the contents of those emails. That is the entire discussion. No one's talking about the corruption that was exposed in it, the pay-to-play, some of the pretty outrageous things revealed in the emails having to do with, like, you know, where our money's going in regards to terrorist organizations. And also, of course, all of the chicanery in the Democratic presidential primary. So that's been my overall grievance with this, is that you want to have a discussion about, you know, whether Russia hacked or not, okay, but what's far more important than that discussion is what's actually in there. And no one is denying the validity of what is in those emails. The government didn't say that it's made up. So whether they're lying or telling the truth is really beyond the point. What's important is what is leaked, was there, it happened. And what I feel is going on is they are trying to shift the discussion to this sort of Red Scare thing in order to distract people from the fundamental reforms and ethical quandaries that have been raised by what the Democratic Party did. So, please, if you're having a discussion about this, whatever side of it you're on, remember, contents of the emails are more important. And I will briefly speak, you know, look, I'm still skeptical as to whether Russia had anything to do with it or not. And my main reason for that is because, you know, look, this is a double-blind situation. What you have is, you know, the government is offered, you know, this 13-page document. It's kind of vague. And they haven't offered any sort of smoking gun that these leaks are actually from, you know, Russian hacks or, you know, an arm of the Russian government. Julian Assange has gone on to say that most certainly was not. That's his stance. That is what he's been saying to the public. It did not come from Russia, a Russian surrogate, or the Russian government whatsoever. However, you know, the government, and, you know, let's give them the benefit of the doubt. Let's say that they do have a smoking gun, but perhaps it's in some sort of, it's confidential. They can't reveal it for national security reasons. Who knows? And Julian Assange can't reveal WikiLeaks source because that's journalistic practice. You don't reveal your sources in order to protect them. So discerning the truth is pretty much impossible unless you can somehow read the government or Julian Assange's mind. I would come to my conclusion on it based on history. And what history shows is that our government intelligence agencies have a pretty sorry history of lying to the American public about situations like this. Comparable, you know, Iran-Contra scandal, Watergate, the WMDs in Iraq, our own attempts to do regime changes in other parts of the world, like such as Chile and Honduras. And so they're the ones I feel like you really need to doubt in this situation. It's like, you know, you've done this before, and the way that you're doing it is very suspect because you're focusing all the attention, you're using it to focus attention away from the corruption exposed in the emails. So that's where my doubt comes from. Whereas WikiLeaks, you know, they have a perfect track record. They've never put out false information. They vet it importantly. And also, just what would Julian Assange have to gain by lying? He would risk the credibility of WikiLeaks, which is something I'm sure him and WikiLeaks would not want him to do. So that's my conclusion. That's the logic I follow. And so I say it's most likely that the government is lying and Julian Assange is telling the truth. Now, by all means, if you come to a different conclusion, that's fine. As long as you accept what was actually in the emails. Because having a debate about whether Russia did it or not is a red herring to distract you from the fundamental reforms that need to be done. And to say, you know, we shouldn't focus on the Russia stuff. We really shouldn't. But we should never forget what was in those documents. Because that is the only way we'll be able to keep holy truth of power and tell them that we need reform. Okay. Whew. So with that, I hope I never have to talk about Russia ever again. I might still post memes about it on my Facebook page, but probably not talk about it on the show. But as a final send-off, like I said, we start every show with a song. So this one is dedicated to the Democratic Party, and particularly the leadership of the DNC during 2015, 2014, and 2016. Thank you for tuning in. This is the Hoodrat Strategist Radio Program, your only source for political revolution.
Russia, step up and take control tonight, night, night. If you don't sweat the pressure, Russia, quite soon you will feel alright. No games to play now. Goodbye to nighttime and hello to the nighttime. It's a brand new day now. Just take their hands and make it right. Your fears, face Russia.
They make you small, but you're bigger than that. You're stronger than you know. Just close your eyes and look into your heart. Sometimes when you feel like crying, don't cry and leave me. Feelings come and go. Better times are waiting for you. Face your fears, face Russia. Step up and take control tonight.
With the party being had, we don't need that big old wall. Brothers and sisters, answer my call. Now I've come to dig into my song. Being a Russian lover really shouldn't be wrong. Being a Russian lover really shouldn't be wrong.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back, and I want to welcome back Luke. Say hello to the people out there.
Hello, people.
Yes, glad to have my co-host back. Yeah, sorry, I didn't realize you were outside the door, and I was already jabbering on my little tirade there.
It works out.
Yeah, so I want to make sure, just because I know Luke has also been pretty irritated by this whole Russia discussion, so I just want to make sure he had a chance to have his two cents thrown in there before we put a casket on this damn thing.
I love the fact that you want to try to put a casket on this, but as long as the big wigs up on DC Hill are talking about Russia, we're going to be talking about Russia.
Well, that's true. Yep.
Unfortunately. So I'll bank my piece for now, mostly because I've said most of it, and it's utterly ridiculous.
Oh, yeah.
It's one of those things, we can be outraged at them after we fix our internal problems,
yeah.
Really.
All right, yeah, so bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, follow the man, not the dog. I don't care if you think the WikiLeaks came from Russia or Seth Rich or space aliens. The corruption is
Hail
what's
Xenu.
Important. Hail Xenu, yes. So, I wanted to start off, we've got some local stuff to talk about, and I wanted to lead off with it because, you know, it's very important, and it talks a lot about some of the political maneuvering going on at the national level with the Democratic Party, and you can see some echoes of it, and what occurred, it was last night at a county commission meeting, so... Shannon Sykes, she is on the Kalamazoo City Commission. I do hope to have a discussion with her about this at some point. Although she did say I could use her, statement on Facebook and read that to you, ladies and gentlemen, on the air. So I'll go ahead and do that. And then, me and Luke will talk about it a little bit. So let me just pull it up on my lappy tap here. Well,
the wonders of technology.
Oh yes. Good. All right. So, it follows. In 2014, this is from Shannon Sykes, I was part of a team that fought to reestablish a Democratic majority on the County Commission Board. This year, I did the same from the chair seat of the Kalamazoo County Democratic Party. Not because party politics are the end-all be-all, but because we knew then what we know now. That it is vital to the health and well-being of our communities to have elected officials in place who stand up for everyday people rather than the wealthy and well-connected. And just a little bit of a side note, being plugged into a lot of people in the Democratic Party here in Kalamazoo, and, you know, I want to make sure Yeah, some of them are radical friends. There's some confusion on them. The actual rank and file people involved there, the vast majority of them, they love Bernie. They're progressives who are trying to move the party to the left. So, you know, don't think demo rats or whatnot. Everyday people rather than wealthy and the well-connected. That bigotry has no place in elected office. That at the end of the day, by definition, progressives are the ones looking to move our country forward. Certainly, sometimes we disagree on the how, but we are always headed in the same direction. Forward. Tonight, that was last night, the county commission, they said they chose backwards. We put petty differences ahead of what was best for our community. We gave the Kalamazoo County Commission Chair's seat to a Republican in spite of our Democratic majority, in spite of the voters' choice to elect a Democratic majority to lead their county. We gave the seat to a man that stood on the side of his colleagues and his party, fighting to ensure Trump won the vote in our county. And while hundreds of dedicated citizens fought to ensure the Kalamazoo GOP was unsuccessful, it didn't matter, because we could just give them control of the county commission anyway. And she goes on to talk about some of the progressive initiatives that have been passed here in Kalamazoo, the homeless millage, responsible bidders policy, municipal ID cards. And basically, it's the rest of it follows is like a call this, you know, solidarity against the GOP. I have another friend on Facebook who talked about it a little bit more, like, how did this actually go down? If they had a Democratic majority, how did they get a Republican? How did they vote a Republican chair in? So, this is from a friend of mine. She's part of Progressive Kalamazoo, and she's a Kalamazoo Democrat. Tonight I witnessed the clearest reason that we must all become engaged in the political process as we never have before. The Kalamazoo County Commission has a Democratic majority of 6-5 by the will of the voters. And that's true. Even though the overall county went red, Kalamazoo proper was blue. But the actual local reps for our county, people voted for individuals who happened to be Democrats by a 6-5 margin. So, from the federal state government, Democrats hold little power, but this one local body is one saving grace. Last night, the newly seated commission voted in their new chair. First, let's understand that Representative Dale Sugars, he's the, I guess he's going to be the new county commission chair, is the most right-wing of the Republican members of the commission. He recently was the only no vote on forming a task force to create a county ID, and he also recently voted against a statement against Citizens United from the commission. Oh, and that already stinks. Like, I'll be honest, I'm just starting to get my feet into local politics, kind of learning who's who, but if you are for Citizens United, I already don't like you very much. So, anyway, when his name was placed in the nomination for chair, he received support from all Republican commissioners and also Democratic Commissioner Stephanie Moore. Immediately following, Commissioner Moore was nominated by Republicans for vice chair. She then won with their 5 votes and her own. Commissioner Moore, okay, well, she goes on to say that she sold out her power on her power and position. And, you know, it's basically editorializing a little bit about being indignant that she kind of sold out fellow Democrats. Now, this just happened yesterday. I've still been trying to get a hold of people who were actually at the meeting, some of the commissioners and such. But my first takeaway from this is, very simple one. If the commission was Democratic majority, 6-5, and I'm trying to really come at this from like a nonpartisan perspective, wouldn't it make more sense for this Stephanie Moore person to be the chair and Dale Sugars to be the vice chair? From what I heard, her whole messaging about it was to like build a bipartisan bridge, but why would you just cede your seat to a Republican?
Yeah, that is a ridiculous position to take when you are in the position of power and you want to work with the people in your community who are opposed to you, but you want to still be able to, you'll still want to be able to direct where the conversation goes. Ceding the top spot cedes the really who sets the agenda, which Democrats all over are just bad at. They're just bad at setting agendas. They're bad at setting narratives. They're bad at convincing people that they are doing what is right. And Republicans are not bad at that.
No.
This just feels like a bad strategy move. Just another terrible strategy move from the Democrats. In show of unity and solidarity. But why would you cede something like local agendas to someone who is okay with the fact that Citizens United is a thing?
Exactly. And you know what you'll see from, you know, you really got to take in mind the metrics of your community. And I'm not going to speak to like the motives of Stephanie Moore, because I don't really know what they are. I would like to invite her on the show to interview her, trying to ask her, figure that out. Granted, I don't know. We've asked people on the show before we've had stories for Mary Balkema.
Mary Balkema.
Yeah, she originally agreed to come on. And then, I don't know, I think she found out the name of the show and got scared off. But what I will say is, you know, yeah, you're absolutely right, Luke. If you look at the way, you got to look at it not only at the general election, but, you know, the primaries. You know, where did a lot of the red vote in Kalamazoo County come from? Well, there was a big crossover turnout. A lot of people who voted for like Bernie in the primaries and then Trump in the general. And what that says, when you have that sort of crossover, it's that, you know, what was the common link? It's that people wanted an anti-corruption agenda. And they were going to give their vote to whoever promised that to them. Now, if you're going to give a seat to a Republican, it seems like you'd want someone who is
as anti-corruption as they say they want to be. Yes. Or it's like, we want to go along with Donald Trump, but even though,
right,
like, even, yeah, but that's the whole thing. The whole deal is that populist rhetoric that was used during the primaries. Both candidates, both Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump, used populist rhetoric, but Bernie Sanders was arguably far more progressive, just hands down. And it didn't smell like a lie from 5 miles away when he said stuff about fixing our infrastructure. Donald Trump utilized the same kind of messaging to the same people: disenfranchised workers in the Rust Belt, disenfranchised workers in the automotive industries, like our coal mining industries, like industries that are, to be completely honest, are becoming obsolete.
Yes.
And talking to the people who are angry that they are becoming obsolete and they don't know what to do. And that, like, that was where the big turnover is, especially when you take a look at those election maps where Bernie won and where where Hillary lost both runs. And it was with the same demographic of people. It was this, like, working class, out of work, underemployed Midwesterners, essentially.
That's
because,
right,
because all of our industry has been siphoned off to labor is cheaper.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, something that comes to mind too is it feels like continued misreading of the general electorate, because from what I can gather, so her idea is like, okay, well, to appease this Republican constituency that had a very large turnout in the general election, I will, you know, cede the chairmanship seat to, you know, this particular Republican who, you know, like I said,
it's just a weak move.
Yeah, it's just a weak move. Sense. Yeah,
it doesn't make sense. It's a weak move. I understand wanting to show solidarity, but as you said, giving the vice chair position would be appropriate for a board that is already majority Democrat.
Right, and it sounds like, you know, from what both Shannon and my other colleagues said, Miss Moore did not discuss this with any of her other Democrats. This came as a total shock to everyone on the commission board seat. Now, if you were going to give like a strategic olive branch to somebody from the other party, that's probably something you would want to talk to the rest of your colleagues about before you did it.
Yeah, because otherwise it smacks of a number of things that taste nasty, but really shouldn't be said unless somebody really wants to look into it.
Yeah, yeah. I'll put on my fedora, ladies and gentlemen, and try to
put on my tinfoil. Put on our tinfoil hat. But
I'll meet you halfway. Tinfoil fedora. There we go. No.
But at the same time, like it's now more than ever when you're taking a look at a large quote unquote Republican turnout. The Republican turnout between just this last election, 2012, there's maybe 100,000 people, maybe 100,000 additional. It was Democrats that didn't show up.
Yep.
It was Democrats that didn't show up because for a number of reasons, but like now more than ever with Republican sweeps in both House and Senate and state houses and state senates and state government governor seats, like if Democrats who have those small majorities, you can't let them go. You can't let them go.
Shooting yourself in the foot for some sort of political maneuvering that is just going to cede overall party power in your county.
I hope you're playing some sort of four-dimensional chess here, because from down here on the ground, it looks pretty dumb.
Yeah. So that's our message. And like I said, I'd really like to pick Stephanie Moore's brain about why she did what she did. We'll have to see how it really develops, but not a good opening volley from our local Democrats. Come on, guys. You got to...
You have 23 months to really... You have 22 months to really get on the ball.
22 months, guys.
Come on.
Clock is ticking. Yep. All right. Well, we're going to play a couple promo spots real quick, come back and talk some more. Maybe more on this topic, maybe move on to the next one. Anyway, keep your dial locked. You're listening to the Hoodrat Strategist radio program only on 89.1 WIDR Kalamazoo, your only source for political revolution.
Is your nonprofit organization looking for new ways to get its name out to Western's campus and the greater Kalamazoo community? Why not use the wider airwaves? For more information on how we can work together to promote your organization and events, go to widerfm.org and click on the Airtime and Sponsorship page under the Support tab.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick little break so that the Hoodrat strategist can strategize his way to the urinal. So enjoy a little brief little musical interlude, and we'll be right back. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. We are back. This is the Hoodrat Strategist Radio Program, only on 89.1 WIDR-FM. And we've been calling out the establishment's BS, and, you know, we want our next story is actually a bit of good news. Oh, my goodness. Perish the thought. I know, like, it's all been so doom and gloom lately. But, so a few days ago, the Republicans, when they got their Senate majority,
tried to gut the Office of Congressional Ethics.
Yeah,
the congressional watchdog group.
Yeah,
the thing that's supposed to keep us honest.
And I think they wanted to change it to the Office of Ethical Complaints that they themselves would have oversight of. So basically,
they wanted to take an independent. So the Office of Congressional Ethics is an independent organization. It's run by neither Democrats nor Republicans. It is there as a check to congressional behavior. It has been responsible for no less than 3 congressmen going to jail now.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah, believe it or not, they do occasionally go to jail.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen very often, but sometimes.
It's yeah. One could argue that it's pretty ineffective, but at the same time, then when you're funded by the thing you're trying to keep honest.
Yeah, it's kind of the same problem that, you know, any journalistic outlet gets into when they're investigating their own advertisers, you know.
Yep.
It's very tricky.
But at the same time, they wanted to make it a complaints department and put it under the House Judicial Ethics Committee, under that umbrella.
Yeah.
And it would just be more for the party of small government. They sure do like increasing government expenses. Yeah.
Basically, you'd be appointing the foxes to police the henhouse. And, you know, I will say, here's the thing about, they did this their first day. And the thing, you know, I got to give this to the Republicans, you know, the Democrats, the establishment Democrats. They'll do similar stuff to this, but they'll maneuver and they'll obscure it with fun little names and they'll try to say. Republicans just don't care. They'll just be like, yeah, we're getting rid of it.
Well, not anymore. They don't.
Yeah, not
anymore.
Well, yeah.
You remember the Patriot Act?
Yeah. Well, that too, yeah. But, I mean, granted, you know, they definitely do their own little Orwellian stuff, but I guess what I'm trying to say is Republicans, a little bit less subtle about it.
Guys, we want to take apart the thing that is supposed to make sure we don't do crime.
Well, as it turns out, maybe they should have taken some notes from establishment Democrats and been more subtle about it, because people noticed. They did not like it. No. I'm going to read a little bit from an article that describes what happened, but guess what? The people had a win. Yeah, and I'm going to tell you how this win happened. So, title of the article is, flooded with phone calls from voters, House GOP drops effort to gut ethics panel. This is by Kira Lerner, and she's a reporter at Think Progress. The House GOP reversed course on Tuesday, deciding in a closed-door meeting to abandon a plan approved less than 24 hours earlier to gut the independent Office of Congressional Ethics. And it goes on to describe, you know, on Tuesday morning, they wanted to... On Tuesday morning, House Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy, he's a Republican from California, offered and the party approved a motion to restore the current OCE rules. The reversal came as members of Congress said their offices were flooded with calls from constituents angered by the decision. We have got just a tremendous number of calls to our office here in district office concerned about this. Represent Walter Jones, Republican from North Carolina, said. According to Bloomberg News, Jones's communications director Allison Tucker told Think Progress the congressman also received numerous emails and messages on Facebook from constituents. After the secret vote Monday night, many people urged others on Twitter to call their members of Congress to find out how they voted. Lists of congressional office phone numbers were retweeted thousands of times. Ooh, so. Here's the thing, you know, a lot of people, there's intermittent debates with a lot of my activist friends about whether, calling your congressman or whatever actually works. Well, I mean, this is sort of a proof in the pudding thing here. And, you know, what it's basically based on is, you know, the whether you're a Democrat, Republican, or the occasional independent that actually gets in there, or a third-party person, knock on wood, we see that happen in the future. While our government's pretty corrupt, and our representatives are mostly representing their corporate interests, their job is still dependent on keeping the vote of the people that put them in office. And if there basically is a certain threshold of discontent, that makes them nervous. And those phone calls, there's enough unique people calling them, telling them, we don't like this. That can hold power over even the corporate agenda that they might be trying to represent. And, you know, for my part, one of the things I'm really curious about this, I'll go on and read a little bit more from the article first before I hop on to another point. So, goes on to say, President-elect Donald Trump also responded on Twitter Tuesday morning, saying that the OCE is unfair, but questioned the House GOP's timing.
I've got those tweets pulled up.
Yeah. Oh man.
Yeah.
So what did he say? I'm just curious.
The tweets, verbatim. With all that Congress has to work on, do they really have to make the weakening of the independence ethic watchdog, as unfair as it may be, their number one act and priority? Focus on tax reform, health care, and so many other things of far greater importance. Hashtag DTS.
Drain the swamp. Okay, so I guess he's still... So here's what I think. So he responded... What came first, the calls or Donald Trump?
The calls.
The calls. So, yeah, Donald Trump, his calls, panders to those folks.
Those tweets didn't launch until approximately this time, a couple days ago.
Yeah. Probably uses the word unfair to kind of signal to the Republican... No,
you still, you got to believe that the government, like... Don't trust this thing that is going to call me a liar or call me corrupt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Don't trust this thing because it disagrees with me.
Right.
Even though it has plenty of basis to.
And, you know, what's really interesting about that, though, is so, you know, we've talked a lot about, like, and, you know, what Mr. Sanders from Vermont talks a lot about is... holding Trump accountable to his campaign promises. And I would be very interested to learn how many of those constituent phone calls were from those very same Republicans that got those Republican congressmen and women elected. Because if it was, and the fact that Donald Trump responded in a tweet, I would guess it was a sizable amount. That is, honestly, I think that's kind of a good sign. If the people who elected you or say who said drain the swamp, apparently at least enough of them are staying engaged enough to know, wait a minute. This is not draining the swamp. This is ring, ring, ring. You told me you're going to drain the swamp. So,
even though Donald Trump himself has said, I don't believe in draining the swamp. I hated it, but they told me to say it once, and I said it, and you loved it, so I kept on saying it, but I don't actually want to do it.
And, you know, funny thing, like, a little applause for that, like, you know.
The very confused, like, wait, are we supposed to applaud?
I feel like it was like the magician is revealing his secrets, like, oh, wow, that's how he did it. Well, you got to keep in mind, like, you know, a lot of those voters are, there's some who actually thought he was going to drain the swamp. Those, honestly, it's a little gullible. And there's those who thought he probably won't, but I like what he's saying. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. And I think a lot of those people gave him the benefit of the doubt.
Some people just wanted that wall. Some
people just wanted that wall. That's true, too. But the fact that constituency actually put their money where their mouth is, or, you know, put their fingers on to dial the phone... that could be a good sign, you know, actually the idea of those anti-corruption people who got Trump elected are actually keeping the Republican House and Congress in check. Now, that still doesn't bode very well for things like all the social issues or Medicare or well, Obamacare or anything like that. But if those people actually care enough about corruption to call in, that could be a good sign.
Could be. I mean, also, I would also have to question the GOP's timing on this in a time when when approval ratings of Congress have been an all-time low, like for the last, what, 4 or 5 years, hasn't broken 10%. Nobody likes Congress. Nobody likes the House. Nobody likes the Senate. Like, talk about an ineffectual government. What is a government if people don't think they're doing their job? I think the next 4 years, what could happen is that Republicans finally figure out that it's the Republicans that are making the government not work.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Due to the constant claims of Republicans, the government's too big, doesn't work, you just stop government. Well, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy when you decide to enact policy based on the government shouldn't work the way it does.
Yes. And, you know, you'll find oftentimes, like, you know, I think it's, you know, it's, I made this very cynical joke. It's like a corporate Republican telling you he wants small government is about as laughable as a corporate Democrat saying they understand working class people. They don't care about the size of government. They just want the government to do different things. They would rather have corporate welfare than people's welfare. Or, you know, that sort of thing. And, you know, yeah, it is funny you mentioned the timing. It's, you know, we've talked a lot on the show about how oblivious establishment Democrats are, but apparently establishment Republicans are just as oblivious because they thought, oh, our guy got elected, we've got a majority, now we can run wild and just enable corruption, even though the guy who got them elected was elected because he ran on a platform of anti-corruption. He's basically ran on a platform of, like, don't you hate all these crooks in Congress? And then the crooks in Congress are like, let's go be crooks now that we have this majority. You know?
Oh, it's so true. It's that disconnect. It's that disconnect from Capitol Hill and their constituencies, because the constituencies are actually big money corporations and Wall Street and lobbies. Mm-hmm. It's not, they're not actually governing for the people. They have no idea who you are.
Yeah. And, you know, I think, like, Trump's frustration probably came from, it's like, come on, guys, don't be so obvious about it. Unbelievable. It's
it's like, come on, man. I've run shell game corporations before. Come on.
Yeah. I think he needs to take the Republicans, teach them a class on, like, snake oil selling.
Apparently.
Yeah, here's how you do it. Yeah. Or take some notes from my friend Hillary Clinton.
Shots fired.
If there's any Hillary fans listening, not sorry. all right. Well, we're going to play a show promo, head back into the discussion. Keep your dial locked. This is the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, only on 89.1 WIDR Kalamazoo, your only source for political revolution.
And every Friday, 12 to 3 is the place to be for hip hop and R&B.
Fat boy.
Hey, what's poppin', man? It's your boy Sick Music, straight from the Sick Music Midday Mix. Each and every Friday, 12 to 3 is the place to be for hip-hop and R&B with me, your girl's favorite fat boy. And don't forget, we're streaming live on TuneIn Radio and our website, widerfm.org. So don't get it twisted. You're looking for hip-hop and R&B each and every Friday with me, your girl's favorite fat boy, Sick Music, live on the greatest station in the nation, 89.1 FM.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. If you're just tuning in, this is the Hoodrat Strategist radio program. We just got done discussing, let's discuss it a little bit further. I want to read a little bit more from the article and tell you, so if this had actually happened, what would have been the consequences? And I think Luke touched on that a little bit earlier, but just to reemphasize, had the House not changed course, Congress would likely have adopted a rules package today that would have gutted OCE, the independent body created in 2008 to investigate corruption and misconduct by members of Congress. The office would have been renamed the Office of Congressional Complaint Review and would be nestled under the House Ethics Committee. The new body would have been unable to make any of its findings public or to refer to them to law enforcement without approval. I think that is one valid point to bring up. Something that Luke didn't mention, transparency. Anytime that our government wants to make it easier for themselves to, make it easier to work in secret, that's always a huge red flag.
I like the word obfuscate.
Obfuscate. Yeah, that is a good one. Obscurification, and like, yeah, by the way, this reminds me of a really good book I've been reading, 935 Lies. Check it out. It's about basically this fellow who does a lot of investigative journalism. He's basically ringing a lot of alarm bells about the state of modern journalism. And this was written a few years ago, and he has a very kind of prophetic epilogue near the end of the book, the importance of alternative journalism that's going to emerge when it is so hard for corporate-controlled media to actually, basically publish news against itself. And same for our government. There's been a push and pull for decades. I think the high watermark was probably Watergate. That's when people really stood up and forced their representatives in Congress to pass a lot of legislation to make transparency to make the government more transparent. Then George Bush Sr. Basically killed that, or at least defanged it for a while. Obama was able to basically kind of reinforce that. Not that he doesn't have his own problems with transparency. Fellow doesn't really like whistleblowers, but that's what it is. It's going to be a constant struggle for demanding transparency from our government. And as long as these things are out in the open, they can be fought with public pressure in a very immediate way, like what we saw with these phone calls. And in a way that historically hasn't been able to happen with such immediacy. Thank goodness for the internet. This story spread on PBS, Fox News, a lot of people covered it because it was hard not to cover, and people responded to it right away because they saw it on their computer screens. So, yeah, the more we know about what our government is up to, the easier it will be for us to fight against their attempts at corruption and whatnot. And I hope, anyone, whether you're a Democrat, Republican, Independent, Libertarian, Green, whoever, you demand that sort of transparency and accountability from our government. So, I think, do you want to move on to this lovely story about Mike Pence?
Oh, let's do it.
Oh, boy. This has a lot of echoes of Flint, and that's a big reason I wanted to read it. This is from Jordan Sheraton, who, I don't know, if you don't follow his work, I would highly recommend it. He's one of the best investigative journalists out there right now, does reporting for the Young Turks. I bumped into him a couple times at Standing Rock. He was very, very much bundled up.
He's everywhere.
He is everywhere. He just travels all over the place. The man is an investigative machine. So, per his modus operandi, he went to investigate an issue that hasn't been getting a lot of play in the national press. And He centered it around Mike Pence, but that's not necessarily what it's about. This is mostly about East Chicago, Indiana. The headline of the article, Mike Pence may be damaged goods before stepping into the White House. And he starts with saying, since our corporate media has become sitting ducks, feeble in the lobby of Trump Tower, you probably have no idea there's another lead crisis happening in the Midwest. East Chicago, Indiana, a low-income neighborhood predominantly made up of Hispanics and African Americans, received notice in July 2016 that the West Calumet apartment complex had 218 times the allowable limit of lead in its ground, soil, and air. This was a fact surprising the residents and citizens throughout the community, even though the complex had been built on top of a lead smelting plant. I gotta say, like, that doesn't seem that surprising. And why would you build residential housing on top of a...
Because they got the land for cheap.
Yeah. That's right. If I'd really thought about it, I probably could have answered my own question.
It's because they got the land for cheap.
Greed is bad, guys. Oh, all right. So, this was a fact surprising the residents. Officials never informed the residents living near or on top of a lead plant, lead emitters, the corroding 6 to 8 decade-old lead pipes underground, and chemical companies DuPont and Atlantic Richfield could jeopardize their health. Most egregiously, apparently after knowing about the high lead levels for 30 years, the EPA didn't do a full comprehensive test until 2016, when it found the dangerously high levels. Jordan reported from this low-income complex in August 2016, as residents were told they'd be evicted and given housing vouchers since the complex was no longer safe to live in. At the time, an EPA official told Jordan that this is strictly a ground soil contamination issue, and unlike Flint, Michigan, there was no groundwater issue. Can you see where this is going to go? Oh, it's a gotcha.
That's a lie.
Yeah, 4 months later, it was revealed that lead was found in the water. Oh, yeah. Any of you at home who guessed that, you get a prize. We got a whole bunch of righteous indignation for you.
Your prize is disappointment in your government.
yeah. So, lead, of course, is a toxic heavy metal that, when consumed by children, lowers IQ and can wreak havoc on your brain, nervous system, respiratory system, and bone development. And that was something we saw happen in Flint, and something we still see happening in Flint.
Happening, present tense. The government is more than willing to try to continue to bury that.
Yeah, and let's just take a brief side note. Flint still doesn't have clean water. I know, like... About a year and a month ago, there was a time before the presidential primaries and all that, I was tentatively kind of putting my feet in activism, and I remember delivering a bunch of water to the Battle Creek Pizza Department for the people of Flint, and a lot of us were donating water then, and a lot of people still are now, but I think the idea was, we thought there was going to be some sort of natural arc to the issue, that we will donate this water for a certain amount of time until things get fixed and those people have clean drinking water. And the answer was, we're going to give you all filters, which
have a rate of failure, need to be replaced, people can't afford them.
That's a big thing too. It would be one thing if, like, okay, give everyone a filter until you fix the pipes.
Our Republican led governments don't want to actually spend the money to improve people's lives and make them more productive.
Oh, by the way, I think Forbes recently called Rick Snyder the worst political leader in the Western world, something like that.
Whoa, Michigan, good job.
Yeah. Michigan, proud to
pure Michigan.
Pure Michigan, with a governor who's got the lowest approval rating in modern American history.
But Andy, he's one tough nerd.
He's one tough nerd, guys. So tough that he ignores the plight of hundreds of thousands of African-American residents in Flint. I'm going to continue reading this from this article, but there needs to be more done to see follow through on this because, and I'm really disappointed in the media. I mean, obviously when am I not disappointed in the media? But the filters happen, Barack Obama visited, and then, story's over. Yep, so everything's good.
No, it's not.
And
it's the opposite of good.
Yeah, it would be one thing if the filters were a temporary measure until they got new pipes in, but there's been no money put in to fix their infrastructure. It's just like, let's put a Band-Aid on it and just ignore it. It's definitely not fair to the people of Flint, especially the lower income residents who can't afford to keep buying those things and still have to go through like this arduous, just everyday crap just to shower and drink. Like, you know, showering for a Flint resident, it's not like showering for us in Kalamazoo. They got to go through this arduous ordeal in order to use water that's not going to make them sick. So that's something to still be indignant about. And there's this very interesting Flint activist who commented recently, like, we need a standing rock in Flint. I don't know if I put a kernel in some of your guys' heads right there about starting to camera. Sorry, I'm not supposed to do calls to action on the show. But you might, if you so desire, want to start.
Just stop playing with fire. Yeah, stop playing with fire and move on.
Yeah, yeah. All right. So let's continue. Actually, it looks like Jordan just made the same point we did. He's like, ask the victims in Flint, Michigan. Which, through the media's complete dereliction of duty to cover, is still a complete disaster zone. He goes on to say, so clearly, Vice President-elect Mike Pence, who is Make America Great Incorporated's co-pilot, has been... hold on just a sec. It's about 6 o'clock. You want to... Let's do our promos and then get back to being indignant about this. Does that sound good to you, Luke?
Sounds good.
Okay. This is the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, only on 89.1 WIDR Kalamazoo, your only source for political revolution.
This is George W. Bush, and you're listening to 89.1 WIDR, Kalamazoo, you know what you're listening to, Kalamazoo, Michigan, man. What, are you stupid?
Are you trying to get your local Kalamazoo business name out to the WMU and Greater Kalamazoo communities? Why not do so while supporting Radio Evolution through underwriting and donations? For more information, please visit widrfm.org.
It's time for our weekly RSO Spotlight here on WIDR Kalamazoo.
Hi, my name is Mackenzie King, the current president of Young Americans for Liberty at WMU. We are a nonpartisan but liberty-minded political RSO on campus. We have weekly meetings about public policy, libertarianism as a philosophy, and communication. We also hold activism events during the semester. If you'd like to find out more information, we are on Facebook, Young Americans for Liberty at Western Michigan University.
This has been our weekly RSO Spotlight here on WIDR Kalamazoo. For more Spotlight coverage, head to Western Herald or YBot Connects on Twitter. To find more information on how to spotlight your RSO, head to WIDRFM.org.
All right, real quick, musical break. I just got to type some stuff into the studio computer. Be with you in just a moment. All right, we're back. We're talking a little bit more about Jordan Sheraton's investigation into what's going on over in East Chicago. So I'll continue reading from the article. And he goes on to say, this part's it's a little bit of sarcasm. So clearly, Vice President-elect Mike Pence, who is Make America Great Incorporated's co-pilot, has been down to East Chicago, Indiana, a few times since the lead outbreak in July, demanding action and answers from the APA as citizens on the city begin to connect the dots as to why they've been sick with various illnesses, cancer, chronic bronchitis, sinus infections, strokes, when they previously thought they had been simply dealt a bad hand. And most of the ill people Jordan met had zero family prehistory for the illnesses they contracted. Jordan goes on to say, nope. While he reported for a second time this past week in East Chicago, Pence held a fundraiser in Chicago. And months ago, Pence felt compelled to leave the campaign trail to visit befallen white folks victimized by tornadoes. But Pence, along with the rest of his radical Republican colleagues, wants to rip health care away from millions of low-income, mostly African-American people. Never felt worthy of his time to visit lead-poisoned blacks and Latinos in East Chicago or do anything to help them during the growing disaster. This will haunt Pence as he enters the White House. The situation in East Chicago is growing into more of a disaster by the day, and the EPA's lead testing is now under the microscope as it comes out they're only selectively testing house sink water, but neglecting to check shower water and home water heaters, the latter being the most important source to check since hot water shower is connected to the home water heater. This, of course, is environmental racism of the highest order, a hallmark of Republicans and establishment Democrats around the country. And with over 3,000 cities emerging with dangerous lead levels, unsurprisingly many of which are populated by poor minorities, Pence and many other elected officials will have to answer for why they deregulated toxic dumping into water streams and refused to rebuild crumbling infrastructure that has caused much of the contamination around the country. Only Pence will have to answer for his environmental racism inside the White House. So, what's your... I'll start, Luke. What's your takeaway from this article?
My takeaway from this article is just one of those things where we kind of...
That's the blue button is for. That's it. all right, yep. So, go on.
Yeah. Excuse me. Yeah. Republicans don't care about the environment at all. It's kind of obvious that they're more than willing to ignore those who have problems that can, over long periods of time, be extremely serious, and they need to be addressed now, or they've need to, or in the case of Flint, it needed to be addressed 3 years ago when it first came up, because it didn't come up in 2016, didn't come up in 2015. The Flint water crisis really started in 2014.
That's true.
So Flint hasn't really had safe or clean drinking water for the last 3 years. And looking at this situation in East Chicago, we're probably going to be looking at something similar. You're going to have lead seeping into people's water and the government not really doing anything about it. Like, I'd be surprised to see any kind of cleanup effort of native lead levels in soil or water, or trying to clean up any kind of waste from the old lead plants. It costs money.
It does.
And it's not profitable. Mm-hmm. So, of course, Republicans aren't going to be behind it.
And
because, obviously, we have to run our government like we run our businesses.
Yeah. Especially in light of, Trump's cabinet, the Legion of Doom, so to speak. They've got direct ties in the cabinet now with business interests who don't want to put up the financial collateral to do that sort of cleanup. And granted, you know, you would have had a lot of those same issues under a Democratic establishment cabinet. But the potential for pushback there is a little bit more. And, you know, I'll give this to Hillary Clinton and, like, the neoliberals of her ilk, is that she is more of a centrist. She's friends with the banksters. She's friends with the fossil fuel industry. And where she comes in is like, well, guys, you got to give them just a little bit so that they'll stop complaining. Like, that's where she comes from. Whereas the kind of Trump brand of corporatist Republican is all like, you don't have to listen to those people.
We should just start saying Tim Kaine, because the era of the Clintons is over.
The era of the Clintons is over. Clintonism. I don't know. Well, who represents establishment Democrats now?
Tim Kaine?
Or
that's Chuck the establishment Schumer? Republican. That's the establishment Democratic pick for 2020 right there, Tim Kaine.
Oh man.
Maybe Joe Biden.
I have heard that one thrown around. And God, that's so dangerous, because one, they'll think like, well, he's well not liked enough to win, but he still could lose because he's associated with the Obama administration and like an old administration. And well, I don't know. Well, this is something that we could spend a whole lot of time talking about, is like strategic decision making for presidential picks in 4 years, but I don't want to get too sidetracked.
Point is, neoliberals will at least toss a bone or a scrap every once in a while. Like, their lip service, they have to back it up with something. Otherwise, you can't lip service all the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You have to do the occasional thing, like, you know, Chuck Schumer endorsing Keith Ellison.
Hey guys, look at this thing I did 4 years ago. Wasn't that great?
Yeah. Oh, I think another good comparison is, do you remember Hillary's statement on Standing Rock?
No.
It was basically said, we need to allow the pipeline to be built, and we need to allow the protesters, who, by the way, we like to be called protectors, by the way, we need to allow the protesters to protest peacefully. So basically, in a nutshell, allow them
screw
to
you
yell.
All.
We're going to build the pipeline, but feel free to yell at it, you know.
It's like, feel free to yell at the bulldozers as they drive by.
Yes, drive through your ancestral gravesites. So that's... here becomes the problem then, is, well, what do you do now? Because using, can you still use public pressure as an activist tool in the age of Trump? And, my hopeful answer to that, I think you can. I mean, what recently, what just happened with the Ethics Committee is proof of concept that that sort of thing is possible. One of the big problems is this whole thing in East Chicago, and, you know, this might be a cynical view of it, it's a racially coded thing. And a lot of the type of people who elected Donald Trump feel just fine ignoring that sort of thing. And the capacity for the Republican administration to listen to dissent or outrage from the left is non-existent. Yeah,
non-existent.
I was trying to search for a word, and Luke found it right there.
It's non-existent. It's mostly because they're tired of us liberals calling them bigots and racists and sexists. And it's I don't know who you are talking about, but like, obviously not all of them.
Guys, I had some problems with the PC culture too, but
PC culture.
The Trump was not the answer.
PC culture does have some terrible things in it, and it's been warped to a point where a lot of the language that we need to use to call out unacceptable behavior isn't usable anymore.
Yeah, it's like when you I hate to say, like, the... Well, I don't want to use, say, like, a cry wolf comparison. I think of really more is just...
it's just an oversaturation of the word.
Yeah, it's the oversaturation of the word, and...
All of my political opponents are Hitler.
Yes, right. That's, there you go.
All of my political opponents are Hitler.
And I think that there was a time where we, because some wonderful things have been happening amongst young people. We're so tolerant and acceptable. If like everybody over the age of 40 just like went on a boat and went somewhere else, this country would be great again. Sorry, old people. Some of the cool old people can stay, all right?
Biden.
Not to totally turn this into Logan's Run, but... one of the problems, though, is a lot of the messaging was off. It was the call-out culture, I think, was a bad approach. What it really needed to be was more of an educational culture. It's like, oh, you hear somebody do something bad and just assume that they're not a terrible person. They might be terrible. I mean, you'll figure that out after talking to them.
But talk to them first.
Yeah. Like, so a lot of people who are like, all lives matter, they're not saying that because they're racist. They're saying that they really don't get it. Maybe they've never grown up or been to a black community and they don't understand the sort of oppression that they're under. And if, a lot of times you just talk about it and have a conversation. All you people who've read the new Jim Crow or, you know, understand institutional racism, you can change some minds. And there are a lot of people in Trump's constituency who I think are in that, at that position. But, again, and this is explicitly, I'm talking about, this is for the white allies. Find those Trump people who are on the fence, who are not like alt-right Nazis, and try to have a conversation with them. I'm not trying to tell, because, you know, I did see a response from, like, certain leftists. It's like, well, you know, the black community needs to engage with Trump supporters. It's like, no, that's not their job. That's your job, lefty. You go talk to your slightly racist uncle and try to talk to
him. Go fix your own... It's like, look, if you really want to bridge the racial gap, you gotta be the bridge.
You
gotta
right.
be the bridge. You gotta make them comfortable enough to the point where they will actually sit down with people, the people they hate.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta be a bridge.
Oh yeah. My sister's family, they're pretty conservative, but at Christmas they were asking me lots and lots of questions about Standing Rock, and they fundamentally agreed that, like, hey, you know, that's really terrible what they were doing out there. Then we start talking about Black Lives Matter and, like, oh, yeah, the police are just brutal. And then, well, then she started talking about welfare queens. But, you know, baby steps, okay, you know. So, you can make progress. And that's what needs to be done for situations like East Chicago. You appeal to people's sense of humanity. Say, these are human beings. They're being poisoned. Can you use your position of power within, like, to bring light to this issue?
Please take 5 minutes and put yourself in the shoes of one of these people who has to live in these conditions. And think about it. And then ask yourself, do I want to live in that kind of, in that kind of an environment or in that position? If your answer to that question is no, then you should be helping. Really what it comes down to, it's simple, like, common sense. Good governance comes from simple empathy.
Yeah, that's true. And honestly, like, that's really the only strategy I can think of for, like, social justice struggles in this era. And also just direct action, like, go down to East Chicago and, you know,
make a stink at City Hall.
Bring them water. Because while institutional change might be really difficult until we actually get some decent human beings in our government, showing that sort of communal solidarity with those folks and doing everything you can, that will build those bridges. That will build those activist networks. That will help make the situation better there, even if the government chooses to completely ignore it. All right, I'm gonna play a quick current event spot. Maybe hop on to another topic. Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, I'm actually gonna pop out.
Oh, all right. Yes, our dear friend Luke has to go help out some friends. So thank you for coming back to the show, Luke. He'll be here. Every week, you think? Or
probably.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
He's, most of the time.
Yeah. It depends, you know, the whole, like, we're both of us are a couple of working class schmucks, so.
We are a couple, we're a couple of working class schmucks who are bad at communication.
Yeah. Yep. Thanks again, Luke. Godspeed. Giving a roommate a ride home.
Yep.
So, stay tuned. We still got some more to talk about on the program. I think I'll be playing a clip from our next president, Tulsi Gabbard. yeah.
I really wish that. I really hope that comes true.
Is it bad that, like, I just, like, other people are like, you know, oh, who's your celebrity crush? And they're like, oh, you know, Beyonce. I was like, Tulsi Gabbard, her policies are just so bomb. Did you see how she's talking about the military industrial complex?
Different strokes for different folks.
Yeah, there you go. All right.
So anyway, everybody, mm-hmm. It was good being back.
Mm-hmm.
Stay angry.
Yeah. Keep fighting.
Yep. Keep fighting.
Yeah. Hopefully we won't get sued by Redacted tonight for that one. But no, those guys are cool. I don't think so. All right. Stay tuned. It's more Hoodrat Strategist radio program on the way.
Kalamazoo is a collective of individuals in Kalamazoo that seek to help the community's art scene thrive by providing venues for shows, organizing concerts, and booking a wide variety of music and art, both local and out of town. To find out more, feel free to visit ditkalamazoo.com to stay up to date on local shows and events.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back. You're listening to the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, only on 89.1 WIDR FM. So, just wrapped up talking about what's going on in East Chicago, and I'll try to look up some resources for that later on. If there's anything we can do to help, I would very much like to make sure that help is given, and you know, it's not really that far away from Kalamazoo. Maybe we can organize some stuff. Who knows? So, same goes for Flint, too. So, moving on to something more in international affairs. One of the things that really gets sidelined a lot and wasn't talked about very much in either the general election or the presidential primary is America's bad track record for military imperialism. You know, if you're a student of history, you'll know, shamefully, especially since about the close of the last century, the late 1800s, you saw, like, the Spanish-American War and all that. It was a lot of times they're fought over corporate interests. They're fought for reasons that... you know, the American people are given one reason, and the people in power have another. Smedley Butler has a great book about that, War is a Racket, and he talks about... I mean, he makes it really blatant. He's just like, I was not a soldier, I was a mercenary for corporations. And that legacy still mars us to this day. You know, there were a lot of conflicts in the 20th century. First and Second World War fought for noble causes. Vietnam War, not so noble, but at least that had more to do with, at least more directly to do with international affairs and the Cold War we were in than some sort of price tag. But what we've seen recently since the end of the Cold War is we fight in these proxy wars where we fund certain groups and fund others. We obscure what's been going on, and some of these things spilled out in the WikiLeaks that were revealed over the course of this year, how our government has been funding a lot of terror groups in relation to the Syria conflict, and basically a combination of looking the other way, incompetence, and basically using our resources to meddle in things that we really shouldn't be doing in ways that we shouldn't be doing it. So I'll go ahead and this is Tulsi Gabbard. She's the congresswoman from Hawaii who... by the way, funny story, establishment Democrats do not like this woman. She broke rank from the DNC, Democrat National Committee, to endorse Bernie. A lot of the WikiLeaks revealed that they did not like her very much for doing that. Actually, actively tried to make sure she didn't get reelected, but... sorry, establishment Democrats. The Hawaiians love their congresswoman, and they wanted to keep her around. And she will be around to fight another day, and like I said earlier, hopefully be the next president. maybe in about 3 years, if I'm still doing the show, I will talk about why she's the best choice. But so I'll go ahead, and we'll play her directly. This is a clip of her from C-SPAN. This is on December 8th.
Mr. Speaker, under U.S. law, it is illegal for you or me or any American to provide any type of assistance to Al-Qaeda, ISIS, or other terrorist groups. If we broke this law, we'd be thrown in jail. Yet the U.S. government's been violating this law for years, directly and indirectly supporting allies and partners of groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS, with money, weapons, intelligence, and other support in their fight to overthrow the Syrian government. A recent New York Times article confirmed that rebel groups supported by the U.S., quote, have entered into battlefield alliances with the affiliate of Al-Qaeda in Syria, formerly known as al-Nusra. The Wall Street Journal reports that rebel groups are, quote, doubling down on their alliance with Al-Qaeda. This alliance has rendered the phrase moderate rebels meaningless. We must stop this madness. We must stop arming terrorists. I'm introducing the Stop Arming Terrorists Act today, to prohibit taxpayer dollars from being used to support terrorists. Mr. Speaker, I yield back.
So this is rather historical. I cannot recall, and you know, maybe there's somebody more well-versed who can correct me, but I cannot recall a time where a representative in Congress or the Senate put forward a bill that directly addressed our financial military interventionism. This is usually the elephant in the room. People don't, our reps don't talk about it. Even, you know, Bernie Sanders didn't really talk about it at length. That was probably my greatest criticism of him, is that while he had a lot of great policies on domestic issues, his foreign policy was basically in step with what Barack Obama was doing. And I have a lot of criticisms of that. He wanted to continue the drone program and didn't muckrake our military industrial complex dirty laundry to the extent that he did for corporate interests. I think a lot of this is just because, you know, that's not his area of expertise. He's more about domestic issues, which, if he'd won the nomination, it would have been great to have Tulsi Gabbard as a vice president. So he basically is, okay, I don't have a time machine. I can't think that way. By the way, all of you out there, like, Bernie would have won. I don't know why. Guys, I really don't understand why you get satisfaction out of saying that. Bernie would have won. Yeah, I know that. And when I think about it, I want to go get a beer. I'm like, he would have won. Why didn't he? You know, I guess it's fun to... It's a funny thing to say to people who are still all, like, you know, blaming everybody but Hillary, or, you know, just don't get the metrics of the election and why it was based on the greatest change agent. Yeah, it's kind of funny to say to those people, but, like, yeah, I don't personally get any satisfaction out of that. So anyway, I was sidetracked a little bit, but I'll read the article. We're gonna break real quick for PSA. And then I'll come back, talk a little bit more about the Stop Arming Terrorists bill. You're listening to Hoodrat Strategist Radio Program, only on 89.1 WIDR Kalamazoo, your only source for political revolution.
Is your nonprofit organization looking for new ways to get its name out to Western's campus and the greater Kalamazoo community? Why not use the wider airwaves? For more information on how we can work together to promote your organization and events, go to widerfm.org and click on the Airtime and Sponsorship page under the Support tab.
This is an open slot in the Wider Clock and could be filled with an underwriting announcement for your local Kalamazoo business. For more information, please visit widerfm.org and head to the support page.
Ladies and gentlemen, just give me a moment or two. Got to type some stuff into the studio computer. Be with you momentarily. Hello, welcome back. This is the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, only on 89.1 WIDR Kalamazoo, calling out the establishment on its BS. So, we're talking about Tulsi Gabbard with her Stop Arming Terrorists Act. She is Congresswoman out of Hawaii. And I'll read a little bit from the article written by Alex Christoforou. I mean, sorry, Alex. And he writes, as Assad liberates Aleppo and President-elect Trump vows to actually destroy ISIS, Obama's regime change war in Syria is falling apart day by day. Democratic Congresswoman Tulsi Gabbard is openly calling out the Obama administration for its fake news. Moderate rebels lie in the very real news that the outgoing administration has been funding and arming al-Qaeda and ISIS jihadist groups. Now, what that means specifically is that, basically their defense for arming these groups is that, oh, these groups are there to fight al-Qaeda. They are like-minded people that we're going to arm and support in order to fight the bad guys. The problem is, a lot of these groups that America has been given funding and weapons to are basically on the same ideological wavelength as ISIS. It's just for whether, and essentially it'd be funny if it weren't so sad, because different branches of our government, I think like the Pentagon and CIA were actually arming and funding opposing factions. And the factions themselves, they're kind of savvy to this. They know how to play that game and milk our government for resources. They'll be like, oh, yes, we're going to help you take down Assad, sure, And they're like, well, I mean, you guys are all about freedom and stuff, right? Right, yeah, sure, and whether wittingly or unwittingly, the government funds these extremist groups who I thought we were supposed to be, the war on terror, I didn't realize, is this like the cola wars? Yeah, you're treating the war on terror like the cola wars, or it's like, what extremist faction do you support, Coke or Pepsi? Goes on to say, Gabbard is now openly saying that the entire planet knows to be true, that Obama has been working with al-Qaeda, ISIS, and Syria for the purpose of replacing the Assad government at the behest of Saudi Arabia and Qatar. Gabbard's tweet is another blow to Obama's policy of terrorizing Syria, and close to 30 days left before the... Okay, this is, it gets pretty heavy with the editorializing here. Calls him a puppet president. Goodness, man. I mean, is Obama a puppet? Me? I wouldn't go that far. I wouldn't call him a puppet president. I would say he's definitely compromised since those promises he made in 08. I will definitely say that. There's a clip I might play where I talk about this a little bit more at length. Disappointment in Obama's administration, but I'll save that for the next show. It's going to be kind of our Obama postmortem. So, going on, Gabbard is moving forward with a bill that may finally put an end to America's state sponsorship of al-Qaeda and ISIS. Most importantly, however, is her introduction of the Stop Arming Terrorists Act, which she presented last Thursday. In her presentation, Gabbard cited prominent publications such as the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal to show that the rebels the U.S. is supporting in Syria are aligned with al-Nusra, which is essentially al-Qaeda in Syria. She is co-sponsoring the bill with Representative Thomas Massie, who says the bill would prohibit the U.S. government from using American taxpayer dollars to provide funding, weapons, training, and intelligence support to terrorist groups like al-Qaeda and ISIS, or to countries who are providing direct or indirect support to these same groups. The implications of that go beyond that. Kind of conflict with our interests in Saudi Arabia is really coming to a head. Because I think the American public is awakening to the fact that Saudi Arabia's government gives a lot of support to these terrorist groups, but our government plays very cozy with them because of our interests in the region. And it's starting to really come to a head where more of the American public is getting informed about these complex international relationships. Not a huge amount. I wouldn't say huge enough amount to... I mean, it's certainly not on the mainstream media, but enough that people are really calling into question what our relationship with those Islamic terrorist groups in the region are. And if you know, you really do your research into ISIS, a lot of it happened because of our government's own incompetence. A lot of the camps that the prison camps we had in Iraq. They function in a very similar to the way our own prisons work, which is, without going too much into the military or our prison industrial complex, basically facilitate criminals. It's like college for criminals. They learn how to be criminals. Well, in these prison camps in Iraq, it's basically like terrorist finishing school. And when we pulled out our resources out of Iraq, we did it in an extremely reckless way where we just let a lot of these folks just go. And they ended up forming a lot of the bedrock organizations that would go into ISIS. So, you know, it's funny because, you know, one of the big lies that Trump during his campaign was like, oh, Obama's administration created ISIS. Well, they didn't create ISIS, but they certainly helped. They... Basically, I guess the analogy I would use is they did not create ISIS, but they basically left all the farming tools necessary for a wily extremist to build an ISIS or something like it. So, goes on to say, these concerns are not conjectures. They can be verified by none other than... Tony Blair, well, man, the writer of this article calls him suspected war criminal, Tony Blair. By the way, everybody, Tony Blair, he is a war criminal. Yeah, I bet you were expecting me to pull back a little bit, but no. If you do enough research, most of our presidents have been war criminals. I think Mimi Solitsky said it best. When he was running for president on the socialist ticket, first act I would do is abolish the presidency because you cannot take on that job without becoming a war criminal. So, a think tank founded by the former UK Prime Minister released a report in 2015 that concluded it was ultimately pointless to make a distinction between the various rebel groups on the ground, since the majority of these groups share ISIS's core belief system and would impose Sharia law if they came into power. And so, here's really down to a nutshell. These groups that we support, the official line is that, well, these groups are like us. They share our values. Well, they don't. These groups are just as bad as a lot of the regimes we fought, like the Taliban, like Al-Qaeda, like ISIS. But... because of the political maneuvering going on in the Trumanite military bureaucracy, those short-term strategic goals are put into a higher priority than our country's core values. I don't want my tax money to fund somebody who's going to take over and become a fundamentalist... fascist state, Islamo-fascist state. We don't want that. That is bad. I don't want to look at my paycheck and think, wow, some of my money is coming to support that, along with a lot of other horrible stuff. But she went into more detail. The CIA has long been supporting a group called Fursan al-Haq, providing them with salaries, weapons, and support, including surface-to-air missiles. This group is cooperating with and fighting alongside an al-Qaeda-affiliated group trying to overthrow the Syrian government. The Levant Front is another so-called moderate umbrella group of Syrian opposition fighters. Over the past year, the United States has been working with Turkey to give this group intelligence support and other forms of military assistance. This group has joined forces with Al-Qaeda's offshoot group in Syria. And then Tulsi goes on to say, this madness must end. We must stop arming terrorists. The government must end this hypocrisy and abide by the same laws that apply to its citizens. And the bill would prohibit any federal agency from supporting a terrorist group or funneling support through other countries that directly or indirectly support terror groups. So, just, you know, if you are skeptical about any of the claims that I just made in this article, remember, this is stuff that has been confirmed by WikiLeaks, stuff that's been confirmed by these independent consuls, sometimes affiliated with, like, the actual UK or American government. This is something that a congresswoman is talking about on the floor of Congress. And if you notice, one, why isn't this huge news? Well, obviously it's not huge news because we want to try to keep it undercover. Mainstream media does not talk about things that could be problematic to their own financial interests, and there's a lot of military contractors and money involved in this sort of military interventionism. So it's not really a story they want to get out there, but the core part, look, this stuff is true, guys and gals, anybody listening in radio land. Research it yourself. It's really outrageous. It is. And we are, you know, our government are hypocrites. And I think the Arab world has a big reason to be extremely upset with us, because one, our own intervention creates terrorists. You know, the drone papers really revealed, like, appalling levels of civilian casualties. And I've used the Batman metaphor before. You know, you kill a kid's parents and he is going to hate you. And in the comic book world, they might become a crime fighter. In the real world, if it's an American drone missile, they're probably going to hate America. And it makes the rest of the moderate Muslim world, it makes it so much harder for them, because what we're doing is we are empowering the people who are oppressing them. And, you know, they have just as much a reason to be frustrated with the American people as the American government. Because when I was younger, I used to make a distinction. I used to say, well, it's our government that's doing this, not the people. But they see, and it's, I mean, the world knows at this point. The election of Donald Trump really symbolizes a lot. But one of the foremost things it does is our vapid obsession with entertainments and with these vapid celebrities. And, I mean, it's all come full circle in the election of Donald Trump. And they see, like, the proof is in the pudding. If I could have made any argument in the past about how, well, no, most of our culture is not like that. No. The representation of our crass celebrity obsessed culture is going to be the next president in just a couple of weeks. And our penchant for endless distraction, for not paying attention to this kind of stuff, for leading just our normal lives, watching Netflix and the TV show without understanding that this is going on, or wanting to understand this is going on, willful ignorance. We are just as responsible as our government is. So what we need to do is support congresswomen like Tulsi Gabbard. This is a nonpartisan issue too. I want to make that very clear. And I got a lot of respect for Rand Paul. And actually, you know what? I'll look up a video from him real quick. Talking about Saudi Arabia, and this is him talking on CNN about it. Just to illustrate, this is a nonpartisan issue. We got to stop doing this stuff.
into law, he would presumably veto it.
At the very least, it begins...
By the way, what they're talking about right now is a... Rand Paul is trying to halt the U.S. arms sale to Saudi Arabia.
The debate of whether or not we should be at war. We are refueling the Saudi bombers.
Oh, and by the way, Rand Paul, if you don't know, is a Republican from Kentucky.
So we are essentially part of the bombing campaign. We're helping them choose targets, and we are refueling the Saudi bombers that are dropping the bombs. It is said that thousands of civilians have died in Yemen because of this. Yes, we need to have a debate over this, and I don't know what the president will do, but he ought to come to Congress and ask for permission. We've given him no authority to get involved in the civil war in Yemen, and we have to ask the bigger question, is this making it better or worse? Are there more refugees or less? Is there more chaos or less chaos with Saudi Arabia bombing into Yemen? So, yeah, it's a debate we ought to have, and no president should unilaterally have this authority without the approval of Congress.
So for you, this is a moral issue because, you know, there's a lot of jobs at stake. Certainly, if a lot of these...
Okay, I just want to stop right there. Wolf Blitzer. There's a lot of jobs at stake. He's talking about the building of the bombs and how... whether you watch liberal or conservative media, watch out for that. It's like, but what about the money, you know? And they usually try to use jobs as like a smokescreen to be all like, this is out of concern of the American people. It was like, seriously though, look, I don't know, where you might stand morally as an individual, but at least for me, if someone told me, it's like, oh, hey, here's a job. You're building this thing that's going to kill a bunch of strangers overseas. I don't know. Would you do it? Maybe if you were really hard up and you had to justify it economically, maybe for your family, but frankly, we should probably be investing in different kinds of jobs. There's a crumbling infrastructure over here that needs fixing. Anyway, sorry, I won't complain about Wolf Blitzer anymore, but, yeah. Establishment media. Ugh. Okay, I'll let Paul Rand keep going. Or Rand Paul. Sorry, Rand.
Defense contractors, stop selling warplanes, other sophisticated equipment to Saudi Arabia. There's going to be a significant loss of jobs and revenue here in the United States. That's secondary from your standpoint.
Well, not only is it a moral question, it's a constitutional question. Our founding fathers very directly and specifically did not give the president the power to go to war. They gave it to Congress. So Congress needs to step up, and this is what I'm doing, stepping up and asserting our authority over foreign policy and that we need to be involved. We should not be in after the fact, oh, we'll give you a consultation. No, we should be directing the president whether he has the power to do this or not. And I do not believe he has the constitutional power to do it, nor do I think it is wise. I think we are elevating an arms race in the Middle East, and I don't think it's good for America. And I think to have millions of new refugees. Look, Saudi Arabia hadn't taken any refugees. They were part of the violence in Syria. Many of the weapons that Saudi Arabia and Qatar set into the Syrian civil war, some of those wound up in the hands of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and then refugees are streaming across the world, and right. Saudi Arabia foments this but didn't take any of the refugees.
Well, there you have it, folks. Hopefully, there will come some real justice on this about non-interventionism. What's very interesting to think about is, at points during Trump's campaign, he ran on a non-interventionist pledge. It's kind of hard for me to say that because, like, obviously, he really went back and forth on that between, you know, why are we in all these wars? Waste of money. And also, like, bomb the out of them. And then, you know, recently talking about nukes. Oh, boy. So, will the next 4 years be any less interventionist? I don't know. Maybe if you drain the... Hey, Hey, if any of you drain the swamp, Trump supporters are listening. Keep your phones at the ready. They start intervening and some more wars. You might want to give your congressperson a call, your senator a call. Give Donald Trump a call. Rand Nagus Trump. So, I think with that, we're going to wrap up the show. I want to thank all of you for listening. Keep fighting. All that good stuff. The preceding thoughts, views, and opinions are not necessarily those of 89.1 FM, WIDR Kalamazoo, or Western Michigan University. Thanks for tuning in. Come back next week for more of the Hoodrat Strategist radio program, your only source for political revolution.